Okay, in this video, I'm going to show you, before you do the initial sync, you should make sure that your QuickBooks file is cleaned up as far as your customer list and your item list goes. Okay, so let's go ahead in and we're going to take a look at how you mass change things in your customer list as well as your items list. So we're going to go ahead in here under File and Utilities and Export List to IIF Files. I do suggest that you export these separately. So first your customer list. And I'm going to save it to my demo files folder here. Save, and then we're going to go ahead and do the item list again. Export list to IIF files and choose the item list. Okay, and name it items. All right, something with IIF files that you have to know when you're opening them. Now, in the later versions of Windows, before you used to be able to just double click and open them and it would open up in Excel, but now you actually have to go into Excel first and open up the IIF file from here. All right, we're gonna start with customers. It's the one you have to clean up the most. So if I go out here to open, and I'm gonna go to my desktop and my demo files. And here, notice how it says all Excel files. So I can't actually see it here because we're not trying to open Excel file. We're trying to open a .IIF file, an Intuit interchange format file. That's QuickBooks language. So I'm gonna say all files, and then I can open up the customer list. It's gonna give me this template or text import wizard screen. I'm gonna go ahead and say finish because it's already preset the way I want it. So now I can go in and actually delete all of these columns up top down to where you start with the exclamation cust there. So that means this is the start of the customer list. All right. You might want to freeze the panes up top. So drag that down, go up to view and freeze panes. That way you can always, even if you scroll down, that top line bar is always there. Okay, there are a couple of fields that you have to focus on. The first field is that there has to be a bill to address in here. Now the bill to address one is usually the name of the customer. Okay, and then the bill to address two is a street name. Three is city, state, zip, or if it's a PO box or, you know, suite number. And then four would be city, state, zip if this was a suite number. So the first thing you want to do is go in and we're going to do a sort by BA address one. So all of them that have addresses in them will sort down here. And I have a couple down here that don't have any addresses. Now, a lot of times you won't know the addresses for this customer or they are old customers. If they're old customers, just bear with me for a minute and I'll show you where to hide them. But if they're customers that you're not going to go call them all and figure out this information right now. So what I usually do is I put in a generic. I usually put in the company that I'm syncing, so your company's address, because that way I know that it's just a generic address. So if your company is my company and it's 123 ABC Street, any town, USA. Okay. So then I just take this and I actually copy it and I paste it down here so that we have a bill to address filled in. And I'm going to save this. Anytime you do a save, it will give you a little ding and say, are you sure you want to save this as, you know, in this format? Just say yes. Okay, so we have bill to address. The next one that I'm going to sort by is ship to address. You do have to have a valid ship to address as well, meaning city, state, zip. It will pick up if you don't have your, if your zip has six digits or if you don't have the state in there, it will give you an error. Okay, so you have your ship to addresses in here. We sort by ship to address and you want to fill in the ship to addresses that you're missing. Okay, just the same as we did for the bill to. The next column that you want to look at is your phone number. Again, if you don't have a phone number in there and you don't want to call the customer and look it up, you can put a generic phone number in there, maybe your phone number that goes in there, so you can put a generic one in. The phone numbers do have to be valid phone number formats. Okay, again, you can't have 123456 7. It'll give you an error. If you have an something that says extension 105, it's not going to pick it up. It doesn't understand EX. Anything that is not a dash or a open parenthesis or a number, it's not going to pick up. It's going to spit back an error for you. All right. Any email? You have to have a valid email in here as well. So it has to be a, you know, something at something.com.org.net, something, but it has to be in the valid email format. If you're missing the dot in the .com, it's going to spit back an error. If you're missing the at symbol, spit back an error. If you have multiple email addresses in here, it's going to spit back an error. Okay. So you don't want to do that. All right. So you're going to go scroll through and correct all your email addresses. Now, if you have a ton in here, I mean, scroll through, fill in the blank ones, make sure that those are filled in. But what's nice about it is it will, during the first sync, give you an error log. So if you get 95% of it completed, then you can go back and fix those 5% based on the error log. Okay. So we have bill to address, ship to address, phone number, email. And then the last thing that you want to look at over here is way over on the right is the hidden column. Okay. So normally what I do is I actually take and I highlight all of these all the way over to the customer name. And I'm going to make them inactive or hide them. Excuse me. Too much QuickBooks talk. So in here, if you see any customers that you are old customers, you don't want to sync them into field service, you don't want that information to be entered into field service, you just go ahead and change this. Instead of an N, you're going to change it to a Y. So we're going to say that this guy, they should all be inactive. Now, if you do the header here, you've got to also make the subs inactive, okay? Otherwise, it's going to spit back an error when you try and import this back in. So how you know it's a sub is it's got the header name, colon, and then something else. That means it's a sub. So those, all of the header and the subs have to be the same. Now, if you wanted the header to be active and maybe one of the jobs, but not the other one, then you can change just the subs to be inactive, okay? So hidden, is it hidden? Yes. Why? That means it's inactive, all right? So we're going to make a couple changes in there. And once you're done, you're going to save this. Again, it gives give you that error code. That little warning box. I'm going to exit out. Now in QuickBooks, before I re-import this in, always go in and create a backup. Okay. Always create a backup if you're overwriting any data. If there's any problems, you want to be able to go in and restore the backup. Okay, so first I'm going to create the backup. Alrighty. And as I said in different videos, if it ever says working, not responding, it's just working. Just let it sit for a minute. Get, you know, count to 10, go grab a cup of coffee. It's actually working for you. All right, so then the backup completed. Now I'm going to go ahead in here and go to File and Utilities. Now instead of exporting, I'm going to import my IIF file. I go through and find that file that I just changed. So it's the customer list here. Okay. The IIF file cannot be open at the same time. It'll give you a warning that it's open and it can't import it. So make sure you close out of it first. So we're going to go ahead and double click on that. It's going to import my changes and tell me, hey, all your data has been imported. So now if I go look at my customer list, and let's just say show all customers, which includes inactives. Here's that one customer right there, a couple of customers, there's one. There's a couple of customers in here that I made inactive. So here's that Mike Violet and that one utility room job that I made inactive, okay? And again, that means that this information will not sync into field service management. So a bunch of old customers, you don't want them up there in your field service database, turn them off. All right. Then the last one we want to fix is we're going to go in and look at our item list. And again, you can delete the top down to where you start your item list, the exclamation point, inventory items. I'm going to go ahead and delete this. Your items, it doesn't have anything that's really going to spit back any errors for you. It's just going to pull the data. But in this item list, you can go in, hide all these fields, and get over to the hidden field here and decide which of these you want to hide or make inactive. Okay, so you don't want them to sink into field service. All right, at the same time, you can come down here and look at your assemblies and just make sure that the assemblies don't have anything in them that can't sink into field service, meaning a customer loyalty discount like this. Those can't sink into field service. It doesn't take discount items. So you want to maybe either create or enter a other charge in here instead of an actual discount item. Same here, you want to create another charge. Other things that don't sync across, you can't sync across, obviously, sales tax items inside of groups. You can't sync across subtotals also inside of groups. Okay. So I'm just going to go ahead and say save here and exit out of it. Again, I've made some changes, made some things on inactive in mass, and I want to do a backup of my file before I import anything back in. Okay. And then once you're done doing your backup, you're going to go into import, IAF file, and import that items list. So all those ones you just marked as hidden, yes, with a Y, they'll all become inactive in your items list now. So that is a step that you want to take before you do the initial sync to field service management. You need to clean up your customer list and your item list so that the sync goes more smooth.